The antibacterial effect of urea. This laboratory study is presented first because it's one of the more thorough and earliest 20th century laboratory research studies on the medical applications of urea. Don't be intimidated by the word pleomorphism. In this context, it just basically means that urea changed the shape or stopped the normal growth of disease bacteria. After medical researchers discovered that certain types of living microorganisms, such as bacteria, could cause disease, it became almost their sole aim to discover ways of killing or stopping the growth of these microorganisms or germs. In this particular study, the researcher James Wilson placed different disease-causing bacteria, such as Bacillus typhus or typhoid, into petri dishes containing urea solutions and found, as had other researchers, that the urea stopped the normal growth of the bacteria. Quote, "In October 1905, at the suggestion of Professor Simmers, I was investigating the action of the Bacillus typhus and the B. coli on urea. I found that as the percentage of urea in the medium varied, so did the amount of growth of the bacillus. With greater percentages of urea, the growth of the organism was inhibited. With 7% urea, very little growth occurred. With 8%, practically none. Urea has an antiseptic and inhibitory effect on the growth of microorganisms." This antibacterial effect of urea was also proven by several other researchers very early in the 20th century. But rather than present each of these studies on urea separately, the most notable of these research findings are listed below in order to give a coherent overview on the important studies on urea that were conducted and published during the first decade of the new era of modern medicine. In 1900, a German researcher by the name of Spiro reported his discovery that urea solutions have a remarkable ability to dissolve foreign proteins. This is medically important because viruses, for example, are molecular proteins, as are allergens. Later research confirmed that urea has an amazing ability to rapidly and easily destroy viruses such as polio and the rabies viruses. And during the 1980s, urine was defined as an extremely effective treatment for a wide variety of allergies. In 1902, W. Ramsden, another researcher, published a report in the American Journal of Physiology further detailing the protein-dissolving properties of urea. Ramsden also discovered that urea prevented putrefaction in wounds. His work is often referred to later by later researchers looking into the antibacterial applications of urea. In 1906, two French researchers, J. Peyu and H. Rahat, published a report on their detailed study of the effect of urea on various disease-causing bacteria. Their research demonstrated that the more concentrated the urea, the more it inhibited bacterial growth. In concentrated solutions of urea, no bacterial growth occurred. The research done by Peyu and Rahat has been referred to many times over the years by other researchers who studied and clinically applied the antibacterial properties of urea. This research also supported the later use of urea as an antiseptic in the treatment of wounds and infections during the 1930s and 40s. In 1915, in England, two other researchers, W. Simmers and T.S. Kirk, published their report entitled "Urea as a Bactericide and its application in the treatment of wounds." Simmers and Kirk were actually military doctors, so of course their work with urea centered around its use as an antiseptic for wounds. In their report, they comment that all the wounded soldiers under our care in the Ulster Volunteer Force Hospital have been treated with urea, and it has been found that infected wounds dressed with urea once in 24 hours give better results than similar cases treated in any other way. Later 20th century researchers firmly established and provided that urea, both topically and internally, provide a wide variety of excellent benefits and produce no adverse side effects. As you read more about the remarkable clinical data on the benefits of urea further on, you'll be extremely surprised that our medical community today has failed to emphasize and use this incredibly inexpensive, effective, and safe antibacterial medicine.